Lord Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita, Tesam satati yuktanam bhajatam piti purvakam. So this, if we just simply always chant and worship Krishna with love, then everything becomes auspicious. Then we will suddenly feel that Krishna is working through us. Because that's real spiritual life. Real spiritual life is not some sort of practice. Are you also practicing bhakti yoga? I am, yes. Very nice, yes. How many initiations do you have? Well, none. Oh. Or too many. Whatever. But that's external. Lord Chaitanya also said, that's external. Yat karosi, yat asnasi, yat juhusi, yat. Yat tapasyasi kunti, yat tat karushva madarpanam. Whatever you do, whatever you eat, whatever austerity you perform, whatever you offer, offer it to me. Do it as an offering to me. No, Lord Chaitanya said, that's external. Bhajatam priti purvakam. Yes, there must be some, the heart must be involved. It must be, we're offering to Krishna. He's not an ordinary person. You know, you don't go as a pujari on the altar and sort of say, okay, here's your grub, right? And it's not like, okay, Krish, and I won't ring a bell because I wouldn't like that either. Yeah. Gosh, while you're eating, someone's ringing a bell. Yeah, but that bell is kirtan. So Krishna, yes, kirtan. He's relishing. So yes, that bell. The bell is ringing as an offering to Krishna. Kirtan, glorification. All attention goes there. And then, there was one scholar, and he visited a Shinto temple in Japan. And then he says, and then they wait, and then they have a bell when you come into the temple, as if the Lord is sleeping. Yeah? As if you have to wake him up. Ding, ding, wake up. No, it's not the Lord who's sleeping. We are sleeping. That's why we're ringing the bell. Yes. Ding, ding, you're in the temple now. Oh, yeah. Yeah. Ding, ding, wake up. Go before Krishna now. Ah, yes, yes, Krishna. Yes, that's true. I forgot about that. He stays there in the temple room. Yeah. So in this way, we are approaching the most wonderful person. We're approaching Krishna. Not just your average, not your just any other person, but really an amazing personality. I mean, everyone would like to know special people, right? And when we see special qualities in people, we admire them. So, yeah, everything about Krishna is special. There's just nothing that is not special. That's the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Right now, we cannot fully appreciate that. I mean, it takes time for us to let that sink in, because we're so used to the ordinary. Everyone's pretty ordinary. I grew up in post-war Netherlands, you know, which was just as drab as post-war Britain, right? Europe had become impoverished due to the war. People were wearing, there was no more fashion clothing. Forget it, guys. I know, nowadays, you know, I mean, it's like, now it's about cutting a profile, right? I know. I mean, some of you have that nonchalant look, and it took 3 hours in front of the mirror to get it right. Yeah. And then, you know, yeah, perfect. Yeah. Act as if it was just by accident. Yes. We're living in a designer's world, you know. Oh, yes. Everything is designed. And your teeth, are they aligned? I hope so.
You could get braces if you want. You're never too old for gunk.
Even in your 60s, you can still have braces these days. I had them when I was 6, thank God. That's over. So anyway, this designer's world we're living in post-war, in post-war Europe, it was different. He had an old winter coat, you know. I mean, it might even have been repaired, but you were lucky to have one, right? Something warm and the coat to face the winter. You had these block shoes, and if you were the younger brother, you had them off your bigger brother, right? You could still grow in them for a few years. You put some newspapers and keep on walking. Blocks on the bicycle, huh? Not that every kid had his own bike, forget it, you know. They had a bike and you were too small for the bike. They put wooden blocks on the pedals, right? And yeah, then the kids would just be able to ride the big bike. Yeah, like this. Different times. So I grew up in that post-war situation where life was more basic, more simple. Yeah. And then one Dutch author who became very famous wrote this book called The Evenings, right? And it was a book about gray people that lived gray lives. They lived in gray houses. They were wearing gray clothes. And even the cover of the book was gray. just totally. No color whatsoever in their lives. Nothing. Zilch. That was it. Something like Coronation Street or something. You know? I mean, oh my God. Yeah, which is one of the classics of the, you know, of the British culture, you know? It's like, that went for, I don't know, for how many years, but it never ended, I think. Yeah. Yes, so like this, you know, the drab material life. Hermann Hesse, as a writer, was a very good writer. I mean, he really knew how to write. So he has a book which is called Under the Wheel. And in that book, he describes these people that live somewhere in a small town, and nobody is very different from anybody else. And you really can't be. And, you know, and basically, once a year, they go to a concert of the local music club, you see, or society, whatever it is. And that's the outing for the year. And, you know, weekly, they buy a ticket in the lottery. And, yeah, it's that drab, dull life. The German word for dull is much better. So I'll teach you the German word today. It's abgestumpft. I knew you would like that. Dull doesn't quite make it, you know. It's dull, yeah, okay, dull. But abgestumpft, my God, when you're abgestumpft, then you're really it, you know, whatever it is, right? I mean, that's dull to the hilt, yes? So, like that, you know, these people, the world where everything has become small, that is the nature of material life. It makes everything smaller and smaller. The mind starts to circle around a small world, mini world. Mickey Mouse, Minnie Mouse, mini world. Yes. No. Oh my God. Mini dreams, mini desires, mini life. And I don't know. I'm not happy. Why not? Yes. Because we, just as we were walking through the park, some girl was singing with a band, and she was getting into freedom, freedom. Now reminded me of my teenage years. But yes, I thought, okay, she's ready, you know. We should give her a book, you know. She wants freedom. Yeah, well, the secret to freedom is to become bound. Okay. That's poetry, isn't it? The secret to freedom is to become bound. Wow. Yes, bound in love. Only there can we find freedom. Nowhere else is there freedom. Can't get out, no matter where you go. I tried. When I was 17, I got a guitar and I sang a song called Freedom, and I jumped on the magic bus. Hey, right? Freedom, here I come. But no. The first thing that happened to me, actually, when I came to Yugoslavia, is that they put me in jail. I stayed in some apartment of a student overnight, and that was illegal. I mean, you know, okay. Yeah, you can't just stand. No, you couldn't stay in someone's apartment. You had to register with the police formally, and it's like, you know, you're going to just stay in some place. What do you think? Zatvor. Yeah, that's what they call jail in that lingo. Yes. Anyway, I had a taste of that freedom. I tried a bit more, you know. But yeah, I lived on the beach in Greece, tried some freedom. But yeah, sand everywhere. Sand all over, sand in your sleeping bags, sand in your sand. After a while, say, time to move on. Right? Too much sand in your nose, sand in your mouth. Yeah, so nowhere in the material world is there freedom. That's it. I give another example. You know, I think I use examples from the Netherlands because that's where I grew up, but you can just transfer them to the UK because we're both on either side of the North Sea, so it's the same thing, you know. So I was walking on the street in the rain. What else would it have been? Right? The rain. People with pale faces and the eternal drop hanging on the nose. Right? So as I was walking there, cold, rain, drop on the nose, pale face, red nose, thinking, oh God. Next moment, I was already in the travel agent. I guess it was the poster with the Palm Beach and the blue ocean that did it. And before I knew it, I had booked the ticket. Hey, Mombasa, here I come. Coconuts, da, 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 da. And I went on the beach and coconuts, oh, coconuts everywhere. Yoo-hoo. Ready, oh boy, oh boy, oh boy. So I sat down under that palm tree from the poster, you know. And I was getting pretty good. Hey, I was right there. And just then suddenly, plop. Plop, scorpion, wow, an adventure. Wait until I come back home and I tell them how I fearlessly fought off the scorpion. Yes, so sort of threw some sand at the scorpion and scorpion was gone. Then again, plop, another scorpion. These trees are riddled with scorpions. Anyway, just go for a swim. I went for a swim. That's what I thought. Then one man says, no, you cannot swim. I said, look, I'm from Holland. I can swim. Yeah. He says, no, you cannot swim. He said, because the sharks will eat you. The sharks? Yeah, when the tide is high, the sharks are out. And so you can't swim. So, oh, well, okay. So I sat on the beach with a towel over my head, baking in the hot sun, waiting for the tide to go down. coconuts, coconuts. I was going coconuts. I was getting cooked on that beach. And I was just thinking, karma. You can't escape it. Either I had a drop on my nose and everything was cold and wet and miserable, or I was getting cooked on a hot beach. But somehow or other, by karma, I just couldn't enjoy. It wasn't possible, even when I tried. Karma's like that. You know, children, okay, this is for the children. Listen, a long, long time ago, yep, okay, you ready for the story? Once upon a time, a long, long time ago, long before your mother was born, right? In those days, my dear children, believe it or not, but people used to carry suitcases in their heads because suitcases had no wheels. Nah, God, nah. Yeah, no, it's true. True, I tell you. Totally true. Oh, children, once upon a time, suitcases had no wheels. Yeah. So the people used to carry them in their hands, and then the fingers would be like this. Like this. You couldn't get them straight anymore. Then they put them in the other hand, and they had two hands, like that. They put it on the back, put it on the head. I've seen even people dragging the suitcases over the floor. Yes, those were the days. And karma is just like that. You take the karma, the English karma, you don't like the rain. Then you go, but you get cold and wet in the rain. Then you go to the sun, and then you get hot and baked in the sun. Oh boy, there's no escape. I have calculated that in the last 25 years, I have traveled around the world 150 times. Yes. And I tell you, there's no way out of here. I looked everywhere. Everywhere. There is no way out of here. Except the chanting of Hare Krishna. One guy in the street was asking me, "What are you guys doing? What are you doing?" "We're getting out of here." "Want to come?" "Yeah. Please come." "Yeah. You know, well, you can stay if you want, but we're going to the spiritual world." Yes. So, in this way, nothing compares. Nowhere do we find that much hope. Nowhere. Nowhere do we get that much benefit. It's like taking prasadam. It's in itself a good experience, I think, generally speaking. Unless it's a hopeless cook, but most of the time... most of the time it's pretty good. And then, but that's not all. It's not just what happens to the tongue. You also get eternal benefit. How can you beat that? With every bite. With every bite, you're elevated. With every bite, you're going up in destiny. With every bite, the future improves. Yeah. So no wonder we're feeling lighter and lighter. No wonder. In the material world, whatever you do, after a while it gets heavy. Like, I used to, for the holidays, when I was still traveling a lot as a teenager, I used to work at the post, and I used to do loading of trains with post bags, right? So, post bags on, post bags off. One is about officially 20 kilos, sometimes 30, not supposed to be, but every once in a while there's a 30 one. That's it. But 20 kilos. So any boy can lift 20 kilos. Hey, you can do 20 kilos. Huh? He lifts weights. 20 kilos. Yes, so I was ready for 20 kilos. But if you've done 100 bags, then they get heavier. They get much heavier. And after a few hundred bags, every muscle aches, and then it's getting intense. Yeah. So it was intense, but it paid very well. So I would do it, come out totally broken with pockets full of cash. And then, yeah. So, you know, I was thinking better broken than broke. And, so, you know, yeah. So quickly make a lot of money, and then go to India, where life was cheap, but also spiritual, where there were holy rivers, right? Where everywhere there was a temple, where everywhere people were worshipping, where everywhere there were devotees, where there was so much devotion, right? Yes, so India was so nice. All that is the mercy of Krishna. You know, we think that a country goes through some sort of evolution, and that then a certain culture developed, like the British culture, you know, like stiff upper lip, the tea, the scones, and, you know, in the interest of your safety. Learned that well from Guru Das. you know, and all that, right? Yes, culture, you know. Her Majesty, who lives forever. It's just, she's incredible. I mean, she should definitely go into history as one of the Incredibles. I like her. She says nice things. She comes up with some clear-headed, good statements. Pretty good. Not bad for a queen. But the famous British culture. So you got that idea that it sort of evolves over time, and then, you know, here on the British Isles, this culture has evolved. No, it's just, it's already there. Different countries already have a basic culture. And just like, and according to our karma, we just take birth there. That's it. The France has always been France, you know. Even 1,000 years ago, France was already France. And Germany was already a very systematic. See, in Germany, when you say you're leaving at 10, right, it's different. In England, if you say 10, at 10 o'clock, people start sort of getting ready to go. And then go down. This is talking about English people now, not about the Indian people. that's something else again. I'll get to that in a moment. But so the English at 10 is sort of assemble and get ready, you know, and then sort of like 10 past 10 you leave, and that means leaving at 10. Now in Germany at 5 minutes to 10, everyone goes to the car. They just get, not 10 to 10, not 5 to 10, not too early, not too late. And they get all in the car, they all sit in the car, and at 10, exactly when it's 10, the car drives away. The first time, you get caught out, you know. And it's like, yeah. So different cultures, these mentalities. These mentalities are already there in life after life. We just take birth there. So India is Punya Bhumi. It is, of course, time, IST, Indian stretchable time. That is another thing. That is another matter. We're not in India. Time is such a thing, you know. Don't worry. yes. In India, you don't have to worry if you're late to catch the train, because the train is also late. So, chalega. Everything will work. Yes. So, somehow or other, we are India is a special place. It is the place of devotion. Sometimes misplaced devotion. If you smear some kumkum on a tree, everyone worships it. For sure. There was a movie, and I happened to have seen that movie. I don't know why, but during all my years of traveling in India, I only once went to a cinema, and I happened to see a movie called Santoshima. And this Santoshima was about one goddess. And this goddess was like something, the Indian equivalent of Supergirl, right? She was like appearing every time some fire and someone caught in the apartment, you know, and then Santoshima comes and boom, takes the person out. A ship is sinking and Santoshima came and saved people from drowning and, you know, Santoshima, right? And then, after a while, there were Santoshima temples everywhere in India. There is no such deity as Santoshima. Doesn't exist. Total concoction, you know. Absolutely. There's nothing in the Vedic scriptures about Santoshima. Never. No. It was just some Bollywood production, you know. I mean, some imaginary deity. But even up to the day of today, there are many devotees of Santoshima in India. Some of you may know about the Santoshima temples. I think so, right? Maybe some of you even seen the movie. But it's so interesting how that works. So we can see that people are by nature pious, but they are misguided. Because the Brahminical culture has become corrupted gradually. Why? Due to pride. When the Brahmins began to claim birthright to their status, then they became very proud. And that pride, right, that destroyed the Brahminical culture. We find that in Srimad Bhagavatam, the Brahmin boy who was proud and who cursed Maharaj Pariksit said it's the beginning of the downfall of the Brahminical class. So it is mentioned in Bhagavatam. So yes, that's where the culture of India broke down. Then it all became too much because it was a little tough to be a Sudra in those days, you know, when even your shadow couldn't touch the shadow of a Brahmana. And if the Sudras had to go in to the Brahminical areas to clean things up, they had to carry a bell, ding, ding, so that the Brahmanas could quickly go into the house, so they would not become contaminated by, you know, these low-class creatures. So, and higher than the Brahmana is the Vaishnava. Oh, yes. And how fallen are the people in this world, aren't they? Oh, gosh. They're so degraded in Kali Yuga. They're doing such horrible things in Kali Yuga. Oh, my God. I mean, the things people eat, the things people drink, you know, like, yeah. In the Jumna Maharaj, I think it was it in the Jumna Maharaj, who said, if you can set it on fire, don't drink it. yes, very practical tip, and so on, yeah. Anyway, so, but the Vaishnavas are learning this very wonderful verse, Trinada Pisunichena. Yes, thank you. So, that one should be more humble than a blade of grass, more tolerant than a tree. Even if someone carves a heart in your leg and writes so-and-so love so-and-so, you don't kick. So, very tolerant. Yes, we consider all of that. Mm. And finally, at the end of that verse, it is said that the Vaishnavas, they're ready to offer respects to all others. So this is really the way that the Vaishnavas can be successful in the world, if we offer respects to all others, to all those people out there. Dracula and his brother. Yes, them too, if we offer our respects to them as well. How to do that? How to look at, it's like, as I say, it's been the weekend and I've stayed, there's this party street here, and we just sort of, and then there's a few party streets behind it as well, and we just sort of stayed on the other side of the party streets. So I've witnessed pretty much the whole weekend, you know. Someone told me, it's the Thursday, that's the new weekend. I didn't see that. Thursday was, they were warming up. But Friday still beat Thursday. And Saturday, I mean, this morning at 4 a.m., there were more people out in the street that was like wishing us good night. That was interesting, right? They wished us good night. I mean, like, okay, good morning. They were still in the night, you know. And so it is in material life. You are in the darkness of night, and we were in the light of day. And that's it. Spiritual life is like that. Night turns into day. And that's amazing. All it takes is a magic mantra. Yes? My dear children, do you believe in magic? Do you? Yeah. No, you don't. A little bit. I do. Definitely. Magic exists. And there are magic words. And if you speak these magic words, then magic things will happen. You want to know some magic words? No. Okay, won't tell you. Because it's a secret. Shh, it's a secret. No, I can't tell you. It's a secret. But if you give me some of that ice cream, I'll tell you. We'll make a deal. He's ready. I'm going to get some ice cream. That's pretty good. You got to get your perks. So, anyhow, the essence is to believe that, is to just have faith. This is a magic world. It's not a dull, abgestumpft, gray world, right? Where nothing is going on. It's a wonderful world for people that do wonderful things. And it's a gray world for people that do gray things. It's a black world for people that do dark things. And it's a very light world for people that are enlightened. Atmaman manyate jagat. We see the world according to our eyes. The world has the color of your eyes. That's basically it. Yeah? That's basically it. So, that's Krishna consciousness. Nayana patagami bhavatume. Oh, my dear Lord of the universe, please be visible on the pathway of my eyes. Nayana patagami. Yes, and when the Lord is visible on the pathway of our eyes, everything becomes magic. He didn't hear it. So, it's still a secret. Okay, so I've been talking and talking and talking like a little waterfall, wave after wave of sound. And the mind is like sort of nicely floating on these waves and going into a semi-sleep state, some even in full sleep. So this is we're starting now the interactive part. And it's time to crank up your brains. I know it's a bit intense, but, and then we're gonna ask you to talk, to say something, and make a comment or ask a question. Throw a challenge, but don't throw things, just words. And then let's see what will happen next. Okay, I'm waiting, full of anticipation. Where's my water? There will be no question until I drink water. This somehow or other, it's always like that. After I drink water, then the question comes. See?
So what are the indications?
Say it loud and clear. What are the indications when the magic words are working? Well, yeah, we hear things, every word becomes a song, every step becomes a dance, we become joyful, life becomes joyful. When life starts working, it means you're happy, really happy, not just happy for a day, but lasting happiness. Not, you know, they have this cartoon of, or animation it's called, of Steve Cutts. You can find it on YouTube. Steve Cutts, and it's called Happiness. And it's it begins with this rat, which is running on a screen. And then there's some other rats, and they're all running on a screen. And then they start wearing clothes, and they look like business people going to office, and then they land on a railway platform and they all squeeze into a train, and the last one, a tail is sticking out, and someone is in on the train, and the train goes off, and they're off to, and everywhere there's billboards, and every billboard says happiness, happiness, and every shop says happiness, happiness on the facade, wherever you look it says happiness, happiness. And all these people walking past these shops looking for happiness. Black Friday, and they go into the store, and all like, you know, happiness, happiness, and super intense. And then the owner of the store on Black of the super store Black Friday, he's got all the cash, happiness. So he drives away in a sports car, got a jacket and a fancy cap. And he's driving and he's having a great time. And then he gets stuck in traffic. Then these characters come, these kind of heavy street dudes. And they just, as he's sitting in his car, they screw the wheels of his car. And there's nothing he can do. So he gets depressed. Okay, sit down, kid, you're blocking the view. Hey, stop that. I'm watching you. And then, so everywhere, happiness, billboards, happiness, happiness, happiness. So after they stole the wheels of his car, he's a bit unhappy. So he looks up and he sees a billboard and there's vodka. He drinks the vodka. Then he just falls, crashes on the ground, this, that. Next, he goes to some clinic for medicated happiness. And then he got his pills. And now, remember, he was a rat, right, in clothes. And he takes the pills, and his ears turn into Mickey Mouse ears.
And he goes up in the sky, and he flies up in the skies, and it's Disney World, and it's beautiful. And he's up there with some birds, and everyone is flying. And then he realizes he has no wings. And then he goes like, anyway, they never die in animation, so there he lies on he lies on the street, knockout, etc. And as he's lying knockout, there's a dollar bill, and it's flying and gets on his nose. He opens one eye, he opens two eyes, then the dollar bill flies away, he runs after it. The dollar bill just flies with the wind, and he follows it. It goes into an elevator. He's in the elevator. The elevator takes him off, and he walks to a door, and he walks, and then he just suddenly winds up at a desk, and it's like a big mouse trap, and he's caught, and there's a keyboard and a monitor, and he sits there. Happiness. So that kind of happiness, no, real happiness from within. That's when we know the magic mantra, it works. Oh yes, it does. That's it. So simple and so sublime. We'll be really happy. No need for pills, no need for anything. Just happy. Yes, please. Hare Krishna. Where did you learn those words? They're magic. Can I show a magic trick? For kids. Jeez. That's a stump the Swami question. Huh? Whoa, I'm not Parasaram, you know. Uncle Parasaram, he will do that. He can take all kinds of things. He can make things disappear and so on and appear. You know, I'm no better than Sai Baba, you know. I mean, I'm a pretty lousy magician, you know. But if you really want, I can pull a watch from my sleeve. That's the best that I can do. But thank you for your question. It's a tough question. Yes, sir.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Sometimes when we meet newcomers and we're trying to explain to them about the devatas, the demigods.
Like the demigods. Yeah.
And we're explaining that they're in charge of the modes. And sometimes we get stumped thinking, how do you explain to someone that they're in charge of the mode of ignorance? So what does that mean on a
day?
What are they doing? What is their activities?
I explain it in a totally different way. You know, the way I explain it is like, you know, when we look at ants, right? The ants are always working, and what are they working for? What are ants working for?
Sugar.
There you go, it's all about sugar. I heard it turns into alcohol, by the way. But anyway, sugar. And so the ants are into sugar, and they work for it like anything. Okay, now imagine that it would rain sugar from the sky. Now, for the ants, that would be like the perfection of life, right? It's rain sugar from the sky. Now, this is something obviously impossible for ants. You know, it's a miracle when this happens. Now, for a human being, this is not very difficult at all. In fact, even children can do it. In fact, children like to do it, right? Take the sugar pot and just turn it upside down, and it rains sugar. Yes. And so imagine
imagine, you know, I would do this, then within a short while, the ants would start worshiping me, and I would become sugar daddy. It's like, yes, yes, you know, and you would get everywhere sugar daddy temples, and they would just worship sugar daddy, yeah. So anyway, so in the same way, there are beings that are greater than we are, but in perspective to them, we are like what ants are to us. So they have control over natural powers, which goes just beyond our imagination. We can't even understand how. So they can control the forces of nature. We can, yeah, we can control sugar. And for the ants, it's easy for us to play God. It's easy for the demigods to play God for us, but they are not God, just as we are not God. They're simply more pious beings than we are, who have more power to control the material nature. Material nature, by the way, exists of three modes of material nature: goodness, passion, and ignorance. So ignorance is the power of forgetfulness, because we need to forget also if we want to be blind. Oh, I want to be blind so that I can do any damn thing without feeling guilty. Mm-hmm. Ignorance helps. So, some desire to forget. Yes, that does too. So be it. So in this way, the demigods control ignorance, passion, and goodness, which elevates and brings us knowledge. Anyway, I would explain it like that. And I think, of course, that's a unique approach, but not standard according to the handbook, but I think, sugar daddy, but I think people do appreciate the sugar daddy approach. Yeah. So it's one way, one way. Anybody else? Yes, sir.
We may bring our...
You have a loud voice, can you use it?
We may bring our material baggage into devotional service.
No.
We may.
Nah. Get off.
Nah.
I thought we're all pure devotees.
That's what I'm trying to tell everyone, they're not listening. We may have like material desires and things like that, but how much should we like introspect and see that and see the root of that? Or how much should we just ignore and carry on?
Anartapasamam saksat bhakti yoga madoksha jay. That devotional service automatically purifies all the anartas from the heart. This is the principal means of purification. The secondary means of purification is the conscious effort, which supports the main effort of engaging in devotional service. But obviously, it helps if we cooperate. So the conscious effort is just cooperating with the purification of devotional service. But the main thing is devotional service and the automatic purification, and not Vedic psychology and, like, you know, soul searching, introspection, psychoanalysis and all that sort of stuff, astrology or reading tarot cards or the ruins or whatever you want to look into. To introspect. The danger of introspection is that you very easily go on the mental platform, and once you're there, then you are in la-la land. I mean, then we are somewhere else, you know, on the mental platform. So, therefore, too much introspection may not be wise. But then again, we have to be thoughtful, and we have to also understand a little bit how it works. So a certain level of introspection, just to sort of understand where we're at, how it all works, is necessary. But again, Nectar of Devotion says, we will know ourselves
in our relationship with Krishna. And that relationship with Krishna expresses itself through service. So we will know ourselves through devotional service. Yes, Krishna Kirtan.
Maharaj, you were speaking about the Trinada.
You have a loud voice also, yes.
So you were talking about the Trinada P verse.
Yes.
Humility, tolerance, and then ultimately respecting all others. Could you give us a scenario or an example in your own life of when it didn't naturally come, but you had to elevate yourself beyond where you were at that time in your life to manifest it? Because often it doesn't come natural, so... just some tool of how we can step off.
Yeah. Yes, sometimes we have to look beyond the coverings. Different people are covered by different modes of nature. Someone who's covered by the mode of ignorance, you know, maybe walking early in the morning, like, you know, loud, at the top of his lungs, or her lungs, right, screaming in the street, and yeah, at that time we may respect them from a distance, right? So we are discriminating, but we know that I'll confess something. I've done it too, long, long time ago, in my foolish days, you know. And I sang with Leonard Cohen, who sang, like a bird on a wire, like a drunken midnight choir, I have tried in my way to be free. And I wasn't. Bird on a wire, how can a bird on a wire be free? It's in an unnatural condition. So here we are in an unnatural condition. And like a drunken midnight choir, I've tried in my way to be free. So we can look behind these people and still appreciate that deep down there's a devotee. Everyone is a devotee. We just have to find the devotee in someone. This is where the respect kicks in. In the Nectar of Devotion, there is a description of Kamsa, and I like it a lot. I call it Kamsa's moment of doubt. Kamsa is thinking, ha, 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 what can he do to me, huh, Krishna? Huh, what can he do to me? I have very powerful allies. Yes, Casey, do you realize Casey? Casey is gigantic. Casey, his manes are touching the clouds. His teeth are like fangs. Casey is a man-eater. Who can stand up against the power of Casey? What can he do to me? What can he do to me? Huh. I've got powerful allies like Casey. Your Majesty, Your Majesty, a calamity, a calamity. What? Your Majesty, Casey, no, Casey, Your Majesty, Casey is dead. No, not Casey, no, he's too powerful. My God, what am I gonna do? He's just too powerful. What shall I do? What can I do? Is it like, you know, maybe I should just surrender unto him. Maybe I should just surrender unto him. How can I do that? What would people think if me, Kamsa, become a devotee? Nah, they can't do that. You know, what will the neighbors say, you know? Yeah, you know, what are Putana and all the others going to say? I can't do that. No way. So then let me go to Vrindavan and torture the residents of Vrindavan. But how can I do that when I'm too afraid to go out of the palace? So okay, with a few dramatic effects that I dramatic effects that I edit. This is the nature of devotion, and I call it Kamsa's moment of doubt. Even Kamsa was thinking about surrendering. So if there's a devotee in Kamsa, then, you know, then even the hooligans, yeah, even the British football supporters, even they, you know, there's even a devotee in them, yeah, yeah. I was in Zurich one time, and they had a small preaching center in a basement, and there's a door, and then we're just doing Nisringa prayers, and suddenly someone kicks the door full force, you know. Anyway, I was just Dalita Hiranyakasipu Tana Brinkam Boom Ki Savadita Madhavirupa Chachaketi, and they were sort of kicking in on the right beat, so it was okay. And then after the program came out in the street, the whole street destroyed. All the shop windows smashed. British football supporters visited Zurich. But there's even a devotee in them. And some of us may have been British football supporters. And here we are today. Just see. And I was a Dutch pumpkin. And pumpkins sometimes transform. Just see. Still orange, but... I see hands, but I also think time is there, and there's hands there too. Okay, then, yeah.
I have a question about this Atma and Manitijaga. Do we also see God through our conditioning?
Do we also see what through our conditioning?
God, Krishna.
Krishna through our conditioning.
Yeah, because we see world. Does it apply also?
Yeah, we see him also through our current glasses. So when we look at Krishna, we don't see him purely. If we would see him purely, we would see him with love. And we'd realize that Krishna is so kind to manifest in the deity, and he's fully present. Now we don't see that. Yeah, that's beautiful. Some say it's kitsch. You know, according to our consciousness, we will see. Some will say, well, the statues are very nice. Yeah, the statues. So there are all kinds of ways of seeing through the consciousness. Yes, everything we see, we filter through the consciousness. When the consciousness is pure and transcendental, then we see with love, then we see everything with love. And it says in the Rig Veda, let me look with loving eyes upon this world, and then let the world look upon me with loving eyes. So this is the formula. Look with loving eyes on the world, and the world will look with loving eyes upon us. I think I should end because there's a time schedule and I'm supposed to stop at 5:30 and I'm just there. Well, you flew all the way from Mexico, so that's very far. Well, not from, yeah. Oh, not from Mexico, yeah. When your boss is Kamsa and your and his secretary Putana, then it's difficult.
How to kind of maintain this?
Yeah, how to maintain this? I don't know. It may get depleted after a while of working with Kamsa and Putana, but when you come back, then come back to the temple more often. It's they're open every day. Just come over. Yeah. Yeah. Thank you so much. Hare Krishna. Thank you. Srila Prabhupada ki jai.
Holiness Kadamba Kanana Maharaj ki
jai.